My talk is really about modeling polarons, primarily electronic structure methods, density function method. So this is going to be a different sort of talk than the last one because it's going to be a more technical talk on how we better use tools that already exist to model polarons and so forth. So before I jump into the technical details, let me just tell you briefly about the school I'm coming from, Worcester Polytechnic Institute. We're located in New England, central Massachusetts, so we're about an hour from Boston, an hour west of Boston, and about 3 hours from New York City. And we are a private technological university. Most of our students are engineering students, and I come from an engineering background. I'm really interested in polarons, primarily for applications in catalysis and clean energy. So that's really where my interest comes in. And I should mention, we just had our 150-year anniversary. I know that's small by European standards, but it's reasonable by U.S. standards, so we're excited about that. So let me just mention some challenges related to modeling polarons with DFT, and I'm sure a lot of you are already aware of these. One of the biggest challenges is the issue of localization versus delocalization. Typically, if you use GGA functionals, with DFT, for a lot of materials, it fails to properly describe polarons, and you'll get delocalized solutions where electrons will be spread throughout your cell that you're using to simulate your materials, and you just won't get a proper description of a polaron. We have methods that have been developed, like DFT plus U and hybrid functionals and other methods that allow us to overcome this error and properly describe or more properly describe a localized polaronic state. There's also issues related to small polarons and large polarons, and we heard some discussion in the last talk about that. And a big part of this relates to the cell that you use to model your system. And if you use a small cell, you're artificially confining your system to be unable to model a large polaron. The solution to this is pretty easy. Just make sure you model a larger larger cell. That just means larger, more computational time, and it's a little more difficult, but it's possible. Another challenge, and this is really what I'm going to be focusing on today, is how do you control the formation of polarons in your simulation at specific sites? And so we might have this material here and have all these different atoms at different locations, and polarons can form at different locations within this material. And as a modeler, I may be interested in controlling where the actual polaron forms because I want to identify the stability of a polaron at this site versus another site. And so I want to be able to control that during my simulations. So there's been a lot of work on different materials, and I'll be focusing a lot on TiO2. It's a material that's been studied a lot for polarons. But there's been a lot of work and studies on trying to identify where the polarons actually at within the material. So an example would be surface of rutile 110. There's been a lot of modeling studies throughout the years and a lot of experimental work. And a lot of these papers, sometimes they have conflicting results about where the polarons, where the electrons reside at the different locations. We published a paper a few years ago where we tried to identify where the electrons were at in a surface. This is the rutile 110 surface. And we have here a hydrogen atom, which is essentially an electron donor. And that electron can localize and form a polaron somewhere within the surface. And we mapped out all the locations. We basically localized the polaron at different atomic sites, different titanium atoms. All these different little balls here. And by doing this, we were able to get the energy of a polaron at these different locations and essentially identify where the polarons might prefer to reside. And what we found was that there are lots of sites that are similar in energy, that are really close in energy within an energy such that if we were at room temperature, it's likely we would have these electrons hopping between different locations. And so rather than having one particular site where the electron is localized at, it's likely hopping around different sites at finite temperature. And key to this was being able to control where the electrons formed or where the polarons formed and then able to calculate those energies of those polarons at those different states. And I should just mention that there's been a lot of other studies that have shown similar results to ours that have looked at polarons and shown a distribution of sites and so forth. And so let me just mention that. We've also done work a number of years ago where we looked at hopping between different sites in order to calculate polaron hopping rates and charge transport. And this is essentially based on a Marcus-Holstein formulation where we have an electron at one site and then we calculate the barrier to the adjacent site, and if we know the barrier, we can calculate a hopping rate and backtrack what the mobility of the charge is. And so I have an example here of TiO2 where we have a polaron. This electron is localized at this site right here, this green atom, and as we move this electron, and you probably can't see, there's very subtle differences up here in what's going on, but eventually we'll get to the point where we have this, where we get to the activation barrier, this transition state, and then eventually that electron will move to the adjacent atom. And by doing this, or by doing these type of calculations, we can get the mobility, but key to this was being able to localize an electron at this location and at this location using density functional theory, and then mapping out a transition pathway between the two states, and so that we could calculate a rate. So we needed a mechanism to be able to, again, localize electrons at these different sites. Let me share another example here just to provide some motivation. So there's been some great work that has been looking at trying to basically create databases of properties, electronic charge transport of various materials. And so here's a paper that was published a few years ago where they basically modeled over 4,000 oxide materials, and they were able to calculate electron effective masses, screen some of these materials, identify which ones might be good for particular applications. Really nice piece of work. And there's been other papers along the same idea of creating these databases of different materials and charge transport properties. All these papers are wonderful. The only hang-up is that they all involve ion transport, no polarons. So the authors assumed that all of these materials follow band transport, and there's some nice theories and codes that will allow you to calculate transport rates. It would be great if we could do something similar with polarons. We could create databases where we could essentially screen materials that have involved polaron hopping. And so that's the dream here that I'm throwing out on this slide. The dream, if we could take all the elements in the periodic table and have some sort of calculator where we map out all the potential sites where polarons exist and we can calculate the formation energies and so forth, and then calculate hopping rates between all these different sites. And then we get some database that allows us to screen materials and predict what materials might be good for certain applications and so forth. So this is the dream that we'd like to be able to do. Let's look at reality. Reality is much more complicated. You go into the laboratory, or you sit down in front of your computer, you start typing away, you set up your calculation, and you let it run, and you come out, you get a solution. It's essentially a delocalized solution. The electrons don't form a polaron, they're spread throughout your cell, and you frustrated, so you go back and you change some of the parameters in your input files, get a delocalized solution again. So you try maybe a different theory or a different approach, another delocalized solution, try it again. Finally, you try hundreds of calculations later and you're just frustrated, it didn't work, and you give up, you say polarons are too complicated, I'm moving to a different field, and that's that. You might try some of the approaches I'll talk about in a second, but the point is that controlling formation of polarons can be difficult using DFT and other electronic structure methods. And that's really what leads me to what I want to try to address in my talk here is basically how can we minimize the computational time to get the desired polaron states that we're trying to model? That's really the key question I'm trying to answer with my talk here. And two auxiliary questions: what simulation methods lead to polarons? And what initial geometries or structures could we use or should we use to model polarons? And these initial geometries and structures are really key to forming polarons, and I'll show you that in just a minute. this talk is really, as I said, nuts and bolts talk, looking at some of the technical details related to using DFT and electronic structure methods. So just to give you a brief one slide on our methodology that we're using for these simulations, we're using density functional theory, we're using the VAST code. We have two different approaches to be able to allow us to form polarons. The first is DFT plus U, we're using PBE plus U, and the advantage of this method is it's very fast. So it's a fast simulation method, so we could potentially model lots and lots of materials or lots of potential polarons at the same time. Another alternative method is using a hybrid functional like HSE06, and HSE06 and these other hybrid functionals probably generally regarded as more accurate than DFT plus U, but they're slow, and that's one of the drawbacks to them. So there are two methods that that we can potentially use, one fast, one slow. And I should mention that HSE06 is just one hybrid functional, and there are many hybrid functionals, and sometimes they do give conflicting results. But this is just one particular method we're using. It's shown to be popular and reasonably accurate for modeling these types of materials. So we're modeling four different materials, metal oxides, two different phases of TiO2. We have half-band dioxide and BiDO4. We're using PAW potentials. We're adding one extra electron to these cells, so we have one extra electron that could potentially form a polaron. And lastly, I should mention that I'm going to present some polaron formation energies, and this is the definition that I'm using. We take the energy of a localized solution, where the electron is localized to form a polaron, subtracting the energy of a delocalized solution, where it's just the electron is completely spread throughout the material. If this energy is negative, then that means polaron formation is favorable. Okay, so we can take DFT plus U, or we can take hybrid functionals, and the reality is using those enough, these methods, is not enough to actually form a polaron. If I just take perfect crystalline material, this is TiO2, and I run the simulation, DFT plus U or these hybrid functionals, in the end, I'm going to get a delocalized solution. The electron will be spread throughout the cell, and it's not going to form this polaronic state. And the reason is because the initial geometry that I give the computer code that I'm running, it's going to determine the final solution. So if I just give it a perfectly symmetrical geometry, then it's going to stay in a geometry that doesn't lead to the formation of, it's not favorable for the formation of polarons. So in reality, the initial geometry that I give to the code is going to help guide what sort of polaron solution, or the lack of a polaron solution, forms. So we could look at a simple approach, is what if we just break the symmetry of our geometry? So we just add some random perturbations, it breaks the symmetry, and sometimes that will form a polaron, sometimes it won't. So if we have very small perturbations, here's two examples where I just have these random perturbations, small ones, and I run the calculation, I'm not going to see the formation of a polaron. If I, however, I have larger perturbations, just larger random perturbations where I'm breaking the symmetry, I do indeed see the formation of a polaron, right here, this nice electron in this d orbital on this titanium atom, and I indeed can see a polaron form. So I need a way to introduce a state that allows it to look, the computer to code to take that geometry so it starts to form a wave function that looks like a polaron. So I can do that again by introducing these random perturbations, and that's great. The only drawback to this is that it doesn't allow me to control where the polaron forms. And because these are random perturbations, then the formation of the polaron is essentially random throughout the cell. And when I'm looking at trying to map out hopping between specific sites, I want a way to be able to control where the polaron forms within the cell. So let me introduce two strategies that we are going to talk about in this talk. First strategy is what I call the bond distortion method. And it's a really simple method where I just look at the polaron site. So here's a cation, in this case like titanium, and it's bonded to six oxygen atoms. In a system like this, these metal oxides, when we form a polaron, the bond lengths tend to increase as that extra electron localizes on one of the cations. And so in this method, what I'm essentially doing is I'm looking at, finding the cation, and I'm increasing the bond distances from my initial geometry, feeding that to the code and allowing it to optimize. And if all goes well, because I've created the state that looks like a polaron, then it will converge to a polaron. And so it's a really simple method. We looked at bond lengths between increases between 0 and 8%, where we just increase them in different increments. Really simple method. I'll point out that this recent paper by Keith McKenna, they used this method, and other people have used this method too, but I just want to point out that it's being used in the literature. Second method is what I call the electron attractor method. And this is a method that we used about 10 years ago in some papers that we published on TiO2. And the idea behind this method is we take our lattice, and what we do is we go ahead and substitute an atom within that lattice. So we're going to replace one of these atoms, and then we're going to optimize it. So for instance, I might take titanium and replace it with vanadium. So if you remember the periodic table, vanadium is one to the right of titanium, so it has a higher nuclear charge, one more proton. And by putting in this vanadium here, what I'll do is I'll attract electrons to that site, because these electrons might be attracted to that higher charged nucleus, and I've created a polaronic-like state, and what I'll have then is a wave function and a geometry that looks like a polaron. And so once I have that wave function and geometry that looks like a polaron, what I'll do is I'll go back and I'll replace that atom right there back with my original atom, my titanium, and then I'll go ahead and optimize my structure, again, using that wave function and that geometry, and if all goes well, I've formed a polaron right there, and everything's nice. And so, again, this is a strategy that allows me to control where, or potentially control where I form a polaron, depending on where I put that replacement atom. And what I can control in this type of simulation, if we're using DFT plus U, I can control what U value I'm applying to this replaced atom, but also what U values I'm applying to all the other cations. So two different parameters that I might be able to play with when I do this type of simulation. And I should mention that this has been used in the literature not by us, but by other people. There is a nice book chapter by some of the participants here at this workshop. It's very nice. I highly recommend it. Small polarons and transition metal oxides. And it has a description of this method if you want to see a little more details of it. Highly recommend it. All right. So let's look at some of the results. So TiO2. So rutile and anatase. And so what I'm showing you here are the polaron formation energies at different U values that we're applying to titanium. And also the results here are different amounts of distortion, whether I have a 2%, a 4%, 6%, or 8%. And these plots, they're really, I don't know, they're not really exciting because there's not a lot going on, but it does tell us that all the results basically lead to the same polaronic states, the same formation energies. So whether it's 2% or 4%, 6% or 8%, they all lead to the same solutions. And that's why these, it looks like just a conglomeration of data points right there. So all of them do lead to polaron formation. So key point here is the amount of distortion really doesn't have much of an effect with TiO2. It doesn't matter whether we distort it 2% or 4%, whatever. It all leads to a polaron formation in these materials, TiO2 materials. If we look at what the characteristics of these polarons are, the geometries or structures of these polarons, as I mentioned, what happens is metal oxides is we get these bond lengths increasing around these polaron sites. And so here we see that, just an example where these bond lengths have increased by 3.9%, 3.9%, 1.1%, et cetera. And if we look at the bond distortions that occur after we've optimized and formed these polarons, we get a plot that looks like this. We don't see any distortions for these particular U values because these polarons aren't forming in these materials just because the U values aren't strong enough. And same down here with anatase. But once we start to form polarons right here, we have a wide range in rutile, a shorter range in anatase, and I should say that the green is the largest distortion we observe, and red is the smallest, and blue is the average. The average distortions are around 3% here, 3.5% for rutile, and around that same value for anatase. Overall, 3 to 4% average TiO bond distortions, or bond lengthenings, I should say, are occurring once we form the polaron in these materials. Let's look at efficiency. So it's great that we can form polarons using this method, but what about computer time? Ultimately, we would like to minimize the amount of computer time it takes to get a polaron solution or any type of optimization, because less computer time means less. That means we can run more calculations. It means we're not wasting resources. We're producing less CO2, using less electricity, etc. So let's look at the actual efficiency of these methods. So here, what I'm showing you is the total number of SCF steps. And so we just added up all the SCF steps from all the geometry optimizations that occur during the simulations, summed them all up. And what we see here is it's a function of the U value that we're applying, and also a function of the type of distortion that we're applying. And right here, this green curve right here is the 4% distortion, and also here for annotase. And more or less across the board, the 4% distortion is the one that gives us the most efficient. And it involves the least amount of computational time required to get to form a polaron state. And as I mentioned here, 4% distortion. Why is that 4% distortion the best one or the most efficient? Well, if you recall back on the last slide, the average distortions for the final polaron states were around 4%. So if we're giving starting with a geometry that's close to the final geometry, then that's going to take the least amount of time. And so starting with 4% and ending up with near 4% just requires the least amount of computer time. Let's look at the electron attractor method. So this is a method, again, where we're replacing the different atoms, in this case with titanium dioxide. We replaced the titanium atoms either with vanadium or chromium, and again, in an attempt to attract electrons to these particular spots. And the results are much more mixed when we use this electron attractor method. And so by comparison, I put the bond distortion method results here. And those would essentially be the dots that are lowest on this curve here, the polaron formation energies that have the lowest values would correspond to the 4% distortion. And when we use this electron attractor method, we get polaron states that are higher in energy, so they're not as stable as the lowest energy polaron states. And for many cases, we get certain combinations of certain results that don't actually lead to the formation of polarons. So we don't actually see any polarons form for most of these results for U values of 4 and 5 electron volts when we're applying that U value to titanium. We did see some polarons form for when we use the bond distortion method, but we're not seeing it with the electron attractor method. And again, here with annotase, we see similar results where here's the lowest polaron state, but we see some that are much higher in energy. So the polaron formation just simply much more difficult with the electron attractor method. And as I mentioned, this is the method we used about 10 years ago when we were doing some work. And if I would have known this, then I probably wouldn't have used this method. I would have used the other method. We would have had a much more, less computer time and a much more efficient process. Let me just mention how these results, the number of steps it takes with the electron attractor method as far as timing and so forth, and you see the number of SCF steps is much greater when we use this electron attractor method compared to the bond distortion method. You see, up to 2 to 3 times slower is basically what we're getting when we use this method. Let me mention how these results, these DFT plus U results, compare to the hybrid functional. So if we look at the density of states of our system, we can identify which of those electronic states correspond to the polaron. And they're usually somewhere within this gap here, within the band gap. And so we can simply map out the location of these polaron states, where they are below the conduction band. And so if it's within the conduction band, then this would correspond to a value of 0. If it's somewhere below, then that would just be a positive value somewhere below the conduction band. And so this, the location of this polaron state really corresponds as it's a function of U, and as we increase U, it moves further and further away from the conduction band, closer to the valence band. And this is a well-known feature of DFT plus U. And the HSE-06 results line up around here. And unfortunately, with annotase, with HSE-06, we saw no polaron formation whatsoever. And this highlights one of the difficulties with annotase, and I think we've heard a little bit, I think on the mention of it, and we'll probably hear more about anatase. But anatase is a tricky material, and then there's questions about whether polarons form or not within the material. But in any case, using HSCO6, we saw no polarons forming in anatase. These U values down here, these lower U values, are the results that tend to give us, I should mention, results that give us gives us polarons that are close in energy to either experiment or these hybrid functionals. So lower U values, again, there, what I just said. Let me jump to a more complicated example, hafnium dioxide. So hafnium dioxide is a, as I'll show in the next few slides, much more complicated. If we have, for instance, if I apply a U value of 6 electron volts, I get a polaron solution that's actually spread between multiple atoms. But if I have a U value of 7 or higher, I have a polaron that's localized to only one particular hafnium atom. And I'll mention that this multi-site polaron has been observed by Alex Schluger and colleagues, and you know, they've done a lot of work with hafnium dioxide, and so we're certainly no experts in this material, but there are lots of papers that have been published on that by their group. So let's look at some of the results with hafnium dioxide. If we look at this bond distortion method, where again, where we're increasing these bond lengths for the initial distortion, and we run all these calculations, as a function of U applied to the hafnium atoms, all of them more or less results give similar formation energy. So it's a pretty consistent method, except there are some outliers. So for instance, we saw no polarons formed when we used this particular combination, or this particular combination here, this 10 eV or 2% distortion. So this is not a foolproof method for forming polarons for hafnium dioxide. The electron attractor method, where we replace hafnium with higher charged atoms with higher nuclear charge, completely failed. So we tried all sorts of different combinations and we weren't able to get it to work. So this particular method, the electron attractor method, not going to work for hafnium dioxide. HSCO6, also no localized solutions, no polarons were forming with this material. So tricky material, hafnium dioxide. So let me just talk a little bit why this electron attractor method failed for hafnium dioxide, whereas this bond distortion method did work. So if we go ahead and look what happens, we take hafnium and we replace it with a tantalum atom, and it should in principle form some sort of polaronic state. What we're actually seeing is when we replace it with tantalum, what we get is a state that doesn't really look like a polaron. Instead, these bond lengths, here again it's a function of U value that we're applying to hafnium, all these bond lengths are actually decreasing in size. They're becoming negative, a negative distortion or shortening. And so it's forming a state that doesn't really look like a polaron. So when we give the code the initial geometry that doesn't look like a polaron, it doesn't form a polaron. So in this case, this again, the electron attractor method is not working out for us. What about when we look at the types of distortions that occur around the hafnium dioxide? We get, again, a wide range of values for the states where polarons form. No polarons form for these lower U values. The average distortions are somewhere around 2%. So these bond lengths are increasing about, on average, 2%. 2 to 3%, I should say. Yeah, 3%. If we look at the timing here, the timing here is that this red and these green curves, they're the lowest number of SCF steps. So that's the calculations that take the fewest amount of time. And 2 and 4% are the ones that give us results that require the fewest time. So it's the most efficient. And the 4%, or excuse me, the 6% and 8%, they just require more computational time. And again, we can relate this to the initial geometries that we use. If we're if the final product or the final polaron state has distortions around 2 to 3%, then using distortions, initial geometries that are close to that are going to require the fewest amount of time. So let me close up with one final material, BiVO4. So this is more complicated. We have bismuth atoms, we have vanadium atoms, we have oxygen. So now we have three types of atoms. And what we're going to look at is the formation of polarons on vanadium. And so you see here this example polaron here with this d orbital on the vanadium atoms. So if we look at the formation energies using this bond distortion method, similar results to what I've shown before. All four methods, or all four distortion amounts, basically give polarons have similar formation energies. You know, they increase as we go with U value, but they all have similar formation energies. So it doesn't matter which one of those distortions we apply with regards to the formation energies of the polaron states. The electron attractor method, like the previous results, sometimes we can form the most stable polaron states. Sometimes we don't. Sometimes we form these polarons that are less stable or metastable. So it's, again, a method that's not as efficient, or at least not as reliable as the bond distortion method. So if we look at the timings, again, here's the timings using bond distortion method. The green curve is the 4%, and it's the one that's the lowest in energy, or excuse me, the lowest in computational time, the lowest number of SCF steps. That's the method that would be, that's the approach or method that would be recommended, because it's going to form the most stable polaron states and require the less time. Here again, the electron attractor method, all higher number of SCF steps, greater number of SCF steps than this 4% distortion, and 2 to 3 times slower, up to 4 times slower here for some of these cases here. So again, not really a recommended method. If we look at the polarons that form within BIVO4, and it's a much more symmetric polaron, all four bonds here are close in bond length, and the distortions are somewhere around here, 4-4.5%, which again explains why the 4% bond distortion method is so efficient, because we're starting with a geometry that looks similar to the final geometry. Let me mention BIVO4 with regards to DFT plus U and this HSE06. So 4% distortion results, we can indeed get results that agree with the hybrid functional if we go up here to these higher U values, and up here around 7 electron volts. And so there we're at with that. So let me just wrap up here my talk then. We've modeled various materials in trying to come up with strategies to more efficiently model polarons. Again, when we're trying to minimize computational time, yet get the most stable polarons to form in our system. And the bond distortion method, where we elongate bonds and then use that as our initial structure for our optimization, that turns out to be the most efficient and most optimal method. It can be up to 2 to 4 times more efficient than the electron attractor method that I mentioned. It's also reliable. Across the board, we essentially got the same results regardless of what type of distortion we applied, which tells us that we're using a method that, again, that's reliable. 4% initial bond lengthening is what's recommended from this work, but I should give the caveat that we've only worked with metal oxides, this group of metal oxides, so using a different bond length may be more applicable to other materials, and so more work needs to be done on that. Electron attractor method, again, it's a method that we've used in the past, but probably going forward, I wouldn't recommend it necessarily. So DFT, so we use DFT plus U, and the U value that you use, often it's a debate about which U value you should use for your simulations, and I'm not going to answer that in this talk here. But we found that U values typically between 4 to 8 electron volts, again, depending on the material, tend to give polaron states. But be careful about using DFT plus U and hybrid functionals. And this is an area of debate and discussion within the literature about hybrid functionals and DFT plus U. And we only used one hybrid functionals. And again, not all hybrid functionals agree with each other. They can give contradictory results. And I'm sure there'll be more work published and more studies in the future on this there. So we have this method for modeling faster, better modeling of polarons. So what's next? Well, this would be the dream. Now we have a method that we could automate modeling of polarons. We could write a code that would basically set up all these bond distortions and run a bunch of calculations and do a lot of work for us so that we could model polarons and have a little more peace of mind that we're actually going to get polaron states from our simulations that are meaningful. So that's that. Let me just have one plug here. So there is a Springer Handbook of Inorganic Photochemistry that's hopefully coming out next year. And there's a particular section of the book, Theoretical Modeling, that's being edited by Annabella Saloni and Christiana de Valentin. They'll be here at this conference. But we have a chapter in this book titled Charge Carrier Management in Semiconductors, Modeling Charge Transport and Recombination, where we give basically a review of charge transport and recombination. So if you're interested in these areas, we look at band transport and polaron transport. But I highly recommend you look at that when it comes out. And so it's there. Let me just end with acknowledgments. The computational staff at WPI have been very helpful. Tong is the student who's done the work here that I'm showing you today, a really bright student. And Michelle Dupuy is a friend and mentor who's been really useful for my work in polarons. And so with that, I'll thank you for your time and be willing to take questions. Yeah, so the answer is I don't know. We haven't run that calculation, and maybe there are people here who know more about that than I do. I mean, we only use hafnium dioxide as proof of concept, so we're definitely not getting everything right with hafnium dioxide. I'll just say that. We just want to use it as a proof of concept. With regards to the
initial displacement was changed, but the final result depended on that.
So there are particularly lots of different solutions that could form, and some of them are not going to be the most stable. And a lot of it depends on the type of orbitals that are forming. So d orbitals, there's five different d orbitals, and some d orbitals may be more stable than other d orbitals. So that plays into it. And so when you see one solution that's less stable than other solutions, it may simply be a different type of orbital. Largely, those higher energy states are just more metastable states that if we could perturb them, I'm sure we could get them down to the more stable solutions.
So you mentioned that in the beginning that you could maybe also do the large polaron in this approach. Did you ever try? And did you do you have a feeling what kind of supercell sizes you would need to do that to see an actual localization on a much larger length scale of a carrier as opposed to having just a flat distribution of the electrons throughout the cell?
Yeah, so I don't. That's the answer. We haven't modeled anything of that, and we haven't attempted anything to model like larger polarons, and so I can't really say anything about it, unfortunately. Sorry.
Chris? Coming back to hafnium oxide, have polarons been detected experimentally in hafnium?
tell you what, I'll leave it to the expert to answer that.
Alex, do you want to say something about this?
I'll say it about my talk. The answer is yes, biotic absorption, but not directly. So, I mean, the problem here is that many of these polarons actually form bipolarons, and so therefore they are very difficult to see in the eye. So, most of the methods which have been used so far have been before used for polarimetric resonance to detect polarons. But if they form bipolarons, then of course they can be detected. And so, therefore, optical absorption can be used. And so, I'm going to talk about that in my talk.
Sergey, about localization. You consider polaron population as a spontaneous symmetry breaking. And when I see that you obtain a discontinuous formation of polaron like phase transition, when you vary the cup instance. Abrupt discontinuous formation of polaron.
Oh, with respect to the U value.
Yeah. Could you comment about the relation to the Gerald and Bloom theorem that there can be cannot be a phase transition for polarons when we consider moving polarons?
Right. So when we're applying this U value, you're right, that we see low U values, no polaron, and then we start to apply higher U values that we form a polaron. So this is, I would say this is probably an artifact of the DFT plus U method. And I'm certainly no DFT plus U expert on this, so I really can't probably comment on some of the intricate details of why that's occurring or not. But you know, this is a phenomena that's certainly been observed across the board using DFT plus U and polaron modeling.
Yeah. There was a question before in the talk before by Chris, to what extent and how quickly does the polaron form? Interestingly, I think you also gave a little bit of a comment on that, or in one of your techniques. Actually, what we often tend to forget is disorder, right? So actually, any real material will have a significant disorder and only disorder. So actually the band gaps are not, or the band edges are not sharp, right? So you have all these tails, which are really related to localization. And actually if you start thinking about that, it probably implies that polarons, it's not really related to your top now, but the polarons form pretty rapidly, right? So imagine that there is an electron, you can see this modulation of the local band edges. And you see the owners in the calculations if you look carefully. Localized states take a supercell impose disorder. Some states drop below and some states go up a little bit, band edge states. And actually, the polaron or an electron, an additional electron, will go always in one of these lower line states that are energetically favorable and vice versa for the whole. So actually, you will have localization very quickly, and then actually, most likely, the polaron will form. Actually, you've done these calculations by putting in these random displacements. Exactly
that. And you so over polaron forms very quickly. That's why I
kind of want to refer to your talk. I think it will prove the polaron
forms
clearer. In time scale, I can't even imagine.
Yeah, that's it.
Femtosecond.
Yeah.
Now that far shorter than we might think
without
any lattice
distortion. So faster or slower than a formation of an axiom? Faster or slower than a formation of an axiom?
Absolutely.
Faster.
That's
Yeah, so this is, I mean, the definition we're using is simply a computational energy, because it's looking at a unstable delocalized energy as our reference state, so the electron delocalized throughout our cell. The difference between that and the solution with localized. And if it's a polaron forming and everything works out, that's going to be a negative number. And so it has no real significance or relationship to what I would say is to the real world, because it's just a computational number that allows us to compare two different...
No, it has direct relation to real world, because it's from a regulation energy of this polaron, by definition. So therefore, so you can compare the temperature in this polaron to be localized, and so that is well known in many cases. Let's say, for example, for titanium, I think this temperature is not very studied. People go with SPM measurements down to, say, 10 Kelvin or something like that, and say polarons are still moving somehow. So, say, what is your take on that? I mean, because basically that energy should be extremely small for these polarons to be moving still in SPM.
I'm trying to remember what your question was.
The question was, how do you use, say, this polaron deformation energy to establish whether polaron actually gets warm, especially at surface.
Right. So it goes back to, I think, what you were saying, that, you know, if we can identify the difference in energy between a localized state, like a band state, versus the polaronic state, that will give us a sense to the energy to form. And you're right, temperature comes into play and so forth. It's tricky from, you know, results that we have, because it very much depends on the method we're using, so what U value we're using, or what functional you're using, or whatnot. So I don't know if I have like a definitive answer that will, you know, answer that for you.
So maybe just a small question, since we were discussing about surface and anaphase and rutile. So you had a graph in which you had an experimental line for the position of the polaron peak in anaphase. So these calculations you compare with are done in bulk, right?
Right.
So I think that these the experiments actually in this case is done for reduced surfaces. I think that in all reduced surfaces, polaron do not apparently form in anaphase, and in this case, maybe the HSC
You're exactly
right. The correct answer. I don't know, but we will have many thoughts on
Yeah, you're exactly right.